Yeah, thank you, Kaiser, for this very, very kind introduction. Also, thank you, Lynn, Bana, and whoever has made possible this series of talks. I cannot think of a better place to give a talk about my book or any book than a library. So thank you. Thank you so much. What I want to do in this talk, and I'll talk for about 35, 40 minutes, and I hope to be able to simply talk at some point if I see that time gets short, I resort to reading. What I want to tell you is basically how I got to this topic. I want to basically introduce a little bit the issue of montage as a principle for storytelling. And then perhaps at the end of the talk, also give you a little bit of a concrete example of what I mean. So montage, as it functions as a kind of a discursive trope in Weimar Germany, is usually associated, is a principle that entails basically assembling artifacts, objects, narratives by basically culling fragments from all realms of experience. In essence, it's a principle of disarticulation and reassemblage. And the way in which it works, particularly in the aesthetics of Dadaism, which is what the montage principle is normally kind of associated in terms of its origin as an avant-garde practice, usually, the way in which it's handled with Dadaism, I should say, and I should show you immediately the first image here, it's kind of associated with a kind of an all-out assault on representation and also on any kind of ordering principle, including narrative. And so just to give you, it's also read, and this is actually one of the iconic images from Berlin Dada, Hannah Höch's collage, Cut with a Kitchen Knife, Dada Through the Last Weimar Beer Belly Cultural Epoch in Germany, a collage that Höch put together, just composed around 1919, and is supposed to kind of give a sense, kind of a cross-section of German society right after the Great War. Montage is seen as registering kind of the collapse of a social and kind of moral orders in the immediate after-war period. So it's in essence, it's a principle that kind of registers a moment of trauma, a moment of dissolution, and that seems completely antithetical to the ordering, if you would, thrust of narrative and storytelling. And what I kind of argue in my book, just to give you the thesis in a nutshell, is in fact this is not does not this kind of conflation or mixing together of codes and media that don't seem at all to abide by the canons of traditional aesthetics or traditional narrative, that is in fact proposes a new understanding of narrative that kind of de-emphasizes the moment of sense-making, of interpretation, and kind of emphasizes or valorizes the ways in which the forms of the world and as mediated through new visual technologies like photography and film interact with the human sensorius, with our ability to register reality. And so it's a kind of an unorthodox understanding of narrative, and I want to unfold it a little bit by talking about three contexts or aspects that may help kind of fleshing out this, or also describe the need for new modes of narration and storytelling. Okay, so the first context is one of a crisis of narrative, you know, which is kind of a trope in Weimar Germany, and that usually is related to the idea of a crisis of the novel as the genre of bourgeois modernity, and particularly the specific German incarnation, the Bildungsroman, the novel of education or formation. So this would be crisis of the novel as one of the contexts. The second context, which is kind of related, is also a perceived challenge to literacy modes tied to a print culture, which means, in essence, to inherited ways of understanding the relationship between text and image, or to ways of understanding the relationship between the book and other new print formats like photojournalism, which also basically engages in the business of telling stories, but this time giving images a priority over verbal modes of communication. The idea of that, you know, given this kind of the proliferation of new print formats, we read in different ways, and so stories will have to be crafted in different ways. So this is one of the things. And then the third aspect that I want to reference here is the rise of the new graphic arts, and particularly of the commercial arts and advertisement at this point, which very much are a completely new field that, you know, becomes professionalized and institutionalized at the turn of the century, comes into its own in the 20s, and that seems to kind of bypass the kind of traditional literacy modes, you know, tied to, you know, kind of 19th century print culture. So those are the three context. And I want to start with to kind of outline this issue of changes in modes and an understanding of narrative storytelling by and also tell you how I actually came to this topic in the first place. It was lo and behold through my first book, basically, which is devoted to the narrative theory of Robert Musil, one of the great, I think, novelists in German language modernism, the man with that qualities being perhaps the work that many of you may have heard of, 1930, first volume, and who he was very much plugged in. He was Austrian, but he lived in Berlin for many years. He was very much plugged into what scholars now kind of describe as this kind of debates about the crisis of narration and the crisis of the novel, and who in the mid-20s writes one of his main basically statements about the narrative theory and references the poetics of film. He references an essay by Béla Balázs, Der sichtbare Mensch, und die Kultur des Films, basically the visible person and the culture of film. And what's interesting there for me in the ways in which Musil, but also many contemporaries, try to think novelistic modes of narration via the example of film, which is now considered as the new narrative mode of the masses. What interests me in the ways Musil describes storytelling is that he basically argues that, like film, the poetics of film, storytelling has to hinge on a principle of kind of recombination. You don't invent anything, you know. Fiction is not about making up stories, but fiction is about really responding and kind of taking the elements of experience and kind of recombining them in new configurations. And that principle of recombination, which then is kind of glossed as a sense of possibility in Musil's then later aesthetic theory, The Man Without Qualities, is very much a principle of montage. It's a principle, in a way, it's a standard, basically, description of modernist defamiliarization. I take something, I insert it in a new context, and I make it new, strange, if you would, in Austro-Hanenian. But what interests me in relation to then kind of specifically to montage strategies is the idea that you treat experience as a treasure trove, and storytelling as kind of a treasure trove of found objects, and you recombine them. In the reflection of another kind of fellow traveler and novelist who was a close friend of Musil's, Alfred de Blin, That principle gets even more radicalized, because with Musil, the idea is that telling stories is about recombining the elements of experience, but there's still an idea of representation. You know, those elements are mediated through language, and language allows us to tell stories, and stories make sense of experience. Okay, so that there's basically a kind of a semantic relationship between stories and experience. Whereas in some essays by Alfred Dublin, the idea is, no, language is itself an object, you know, and you just basically, as a writer, what you do is you manipulate this object. Storytelling is not an issue of representation, but it's an issue of making. You manipulate things, and the story that comes out of this work of manipulation, this is actually the early Dublin, 1913, in an essay that is called Berlin Program, what comes out of that is another object. So, and I was very intrigued by this, so that in a way, what you have here, the important thing about this object that Dublin calls narrative, you know, in this very brash avant-garde fashion, 1913, is, you know, this object is gonna be basically placed alongside other objects in experience, and just by its presence will change the orders of the real. It's not because we make sense of it, it's not because we interpret it necessarily, although there is a moment of interpretation, but narrative is about this kind of direct manipulation, this kind of direct intervention. And so I thought, how is this gonna work? You know, and for Dublin, then later on, particularly there's an essay on the structure of the epic work. For Dublin, later on, then the idea becomes through this kind of reshuffling and manipulation, that this kind of operation will also be able to create a new collective. That the whole idea is really to create a mode of narrative that is a kind of a new epic. And the result is basically to through this kind of narrative objects is that new bonds of collectivity or reciprocity will be established. Okay. And in dealing with this kind of, to me, kind of very unorthodox understanding of narrative and storytelling, I then and the idea that narrative is really about not sense making, but a certain kind of experience, of collective experience, experientiality, if you would. I then saw a lot of overlaps with contemporary advertisement, you know, with this kind of burgeoning field of advertisement that, as I said, is becoming kind of institutionalized and professionalized in the teens and the 20s. And I chanced upon an article by an art historian at UC Irvine. She's now a professor emerita, Sally Stein, whose work is actually primarily on American photography, both documentary photography and press photography from the 1920s, actually 30s and 40s primarily. And she has a very interesting article in a book titled Montage of Modern Life that in order to kind of examine the fairly safe, so the context here is what kind of experience does advertisement create and what are the ties to this other kind of storytelling that I'm trying to describe, okay? So, and why American advertisement? Because American advertisement at this time seems to be actually very safe in terms of the visual strategies of representation that it engages with. And Sally Stein compares it then to German advertisement of the same time from the 20s, you know, which is much more radical in its abstraction. And it's kind of a sense of aggression or of activation of the audience. So what interests me in Stein's kind of comparison between German and American advertisement is how montage works in the juxtaposition of fragments that are basically taken from a myriad contexts and inserted in a new context and refunctionalized, made to signify in new ways. You know, this is basically a standard definition of montage. And for Stein, what catches her eye is that American advertising agencies, I should say, not necessarily commercial artists, but advertising agencies are very careful on how they use this kind of montage principle, are very careful both in terms of the ways in which they tend to keep very safe distinction between verbal inserts and visual inserts, but also they're very careful about not tampering with the human body. And so, for instance, in this image, what you see is basically New Freedom for Secretaries. It's supposed to be this typewriter here, and it's kind of an allegorical, emblematic composition. There's a woman, presumably a secretary, standing on a pedestal and kind of symbolizing the Statue of Liberty of secretaries, if you would, you know, and so being basically freed and liberated by this new tool. One could say a lot about this. And so just compare this, for instance, and this is actually the one good quality, I'm sorry, not this one. I think this one is also interesting. The women and carrots I could just go through. But actually, the women and carrots I can kind of look, we can look at also, you know, just this idea is here kind of later, but you know, you have this oversized carrot, and one could speculate, phallic symbol, whatever, the women are all you know, afraid of it, and you know, very laborious textual insert, just barely bleeding onto the image. But you know, after reading this whole thing, you know, you find out that basically women and carrots have the same kind of enemy in common, and that's dryness, you know. And then the elaborate story of this is that this is the product is right here, very small in essence, but that as I understand it, at least refrigerators or this kind of brand of refrigerator helps keep carrots really fresh and moist, and so that women's skin will be fresh. And so this is basically, so this is the kind of storytelling that is going on here. But notice here too, it's not an illusionistic space. You know, we have this oversized carrot and minuscule women, you know, but there's no tampering with the contours of the objects themselves. You know, there's kind of overlapping, but no tampering. And so now let's go here to, and this unfortunately I cannot find a good image of the original photomontage by Otto Humbel, but basically this is the cover for the Czech edition, the second edition of Egon Hirvinkis's The Rasende Reporter, The Racing Reporter or The Raging Reporter. And look what happens to the human figure. I mean, it's basically this is actually a drawing. But we have, in essence, this kind of reporter cyborg who kind of walks, again, oversized, seems to be walking, you know, kind of in a menacing way over this kind of just urban landscape. And there's not much to the human body there. And so what Stein concludes, you know, is that at this time, German language, the media environment, the German language media environment has a far a higher threshold for visual violence, you would say, you know, but really a higher tolerance for a mode of representation that really tampers with the with the human body, with the intactness of reality. And whereas, you know, what American advertisers are doing, in essence, they're using this moment of titillation of montage, this kind of surprising juxtaposition of things, even you know, suggesting kind of also this moment of threat of a reality that is unhinged and not in scale, But then they're kind of folding it into what then comes across as non-illusionistic, but still a kind of realistic representation, something that we can really, that audiences can relate to as what reality is. So this is what the conclusion that Stein draws. But for me, the main, and in relation to this understanding of storytelling that I'm interested in, the takeaway is that images like this one here, that audiences can perceive the violation of montage as a literal defilement because they ascribe to a certain extent a kind of an indexical quality to the fragments, because they read those fragments not simply as signs that are kind of folded into a semiotic representation, into a message, but because they see them as material traces of the real that has been kind of recombined. So they in a way, there's an assumption about the materiality of these fragments that it does not efface itself in this moment of storytelling, but remains there. And so that's for me one of the explains why then presumably, and again, it's a fear that more advertising agencies had more than about American audiences. I'm not sure of that. So this is basically to make, I'm sorry, let me perhaps. And then the second element is also a sense of, and this is a poster advertising the international exhibition of the German of the Werkbund, which was an association, a very important association for architects and artists and graphic designers, which work kind of a link between freelance artists and industry. So this is a poster for a very seminal, very important exhibition in Stuttgart, 1929, on film and photo, which are considered kind of new kind of modes of communication. And I guess the point that I want to make, we probably don't have time to read this necessarily, is the extent to which the enthusiasm about this new kind of narrative principle of montage that I'm trying to describe attaches to an understanding of photography and film as technologies that make the world visible anew as a surface. They particularly that make the world that allow for making copies of the world, if you would, indexical copies, copies that have this kind of status of material traces, and that allow for recombining fragments of those copies in ways that interact with the human sensorium, sometimes by also circumscribing kind of the intervention of consciousness, if you would, or of conceptual knowledge. So that this kind of storytelling is very much about the possibility of having kind of the moment of perception, of the perception of forms, as mediated through technology and as they interact with our ability to perceive those forms. This moment of perception being kind of independent of the moment of storytelling, of whatever meanings we may assign to the fragments. Okay, so this is, so let me perhaps try to make it, and the thinker really, in my view, brings this all together is Walter Benjamin. And in my book, I have two chapters on Walter Benjamin, one on the fairly complex, on his fairly complex essay on the storyteller from 1936, and one on the art, on on the treatise or essay, longer essay, The Artwork in the Age of Its Technological Reproducibility. And the reason why I go to Walter Benjamin to kind of flesh out this theoretically, methodologically, this kind of understanding of storytelling as not privileging the moment of interpretation, but kind of emphasizing the materiality of the stuff of the story and its ability to affect perception, is that Benjamin was, first of all, certainly after 1923, he's very much kind of in touch with avant-garde circles, you know, in Berlin, but also is very interested. So in Dadaism, in Constructivism, has a big polemics with the label New Objectivity, but also is interested in Surrealism. So he really understands, in a way, in my view, and also has the kind of theoretical and philosophical chops that many of the artists that I look at did not. So in a way, in my view, he understands what they're doing and can place it, you know, within kind of an historical and philosophical framework that is truly, truly helpful. So, and then the second reason why I think Benjamin is very important in trying to get to this idea of storytelling is that he really raises the question of narrative not from the standpoint of either the demise of certain genres or forms like the novel or print media and the rise of film, but really raises the question of storytelling from as a practice, as an anthropological practice that indexes a certain type of experience, of modern experience. So his point of departure is really to ask what is the function of storytelling and what do the changes of storytelling in modernity tell us about modern experience? So this starting from experience and from storytelling as a practice then gives him a completely different access to the issue of the collapse of the Bildungsroman or of the rise of film than other thinkers and theorists. So this is what interests me. So what what I want to do is show you, this is going to be probably my last slide, show you, talk about this photo montage by John Hartfield, 1930, before I do so, I'm sorry. I use it to describe two aspects of montage storytelling that that interest me in the book. And one is this idea of kind of bringing together, juxtaposing different visual and verbal material in compositions that really harness the power of photography to claim the evidence of reality. You know, this kind of evidentiary force of photography. And to be a material trace of the real, and to remain a material place even when then the fragment is being made to signify in certain ways. And so then to look at the ways in which, the moment of perception then within this kind of account or narrative remains kind of separate or is not completely subsumed under the moment of meaning, and so that in a way you could argue the shock effect of montage lies in this kind of separation, in the fact that there is something like the material quality of the image or the indexical quality of the image that cannot really be resolved in the moment of storytelling or interpretation. So. And so let me get to my last image here. Again, a photo montage by John Hartfield. Hartfield, a former, at this point, 1930, former Dadaist, a fervent communist, one of the most incisive montage artists of the 20th century, especially well known for a series of photo montages that he did for the Arbeiter Illustrierte Zeitung, the Workers Illustrated magazine, which was a weekly, a left-leaning weekly, close to the Communist Party, not under control of the Communist Party at this point. And so this image, June 1930, the backdrop at this point is that of kind of worldwide economic meltdown as a result of the Wall Street crash in 1929, political polarization, strikes, mass unemployment. And what this image kind of illustrates are the divisions within the German left. So that the image itself is kind of deploys kind of vintage strategies that are very representative for the ways Hartfield operated, and it kind of hinges on a strategy of literalization. And what is being kind of depicted here is a worker who is being duped by the lies propagated in by the press of the bourgeois left. So basically what we see here, this worker has his head wrapped in newspapers, dailies, Tempo, and particularly Vorwärts, Forward, which is the newspapers of the Socialist Party, belonged to a centrist left that recognized or basically reformist left that sought to work within the parameters of liberal democracy in Weimar Germany, and was seen by the radical left, particularly by the Communist Party, as having betrayed, basically the principles of the left. So in essence, the worker here is being manipulated by left bourgeois newspapers, and who should instead, obviously, and this is basically the message, read the Workers' Illustrated magazine, so that we have, in a way, the through this photo montage, the Eizett that poses as a source of truth and debunks then the lies of the reformist left, or particularly of the press, that promotes the reformist left. And as I said, what is vintage here for Hartfield is this kind of strategy of literalization. So if the problem are the newspapers, who act as a blindfold for the unsuspecting worker, the newspapers then become an actual blindfold, right? They not only block the man's vision, they in fact almost make up his head, because you cannot really tell whether or not there is a face behind the newspapers here. And again, this is a typical, a typical example of montage strategies at this time, because it kind of exemplifies, well, first of all, what is typical for Hartfield here is the fact that it's a very almost pedantic kind of composition that is being rephotographed so as to pass as an untempered or straight photograph, right? And so the first viewing, one expects to see a real person, and instead sees a man or a person with a face kind of wrapped in newspapers. And so the picture itself kind of poses a riddle to the viewer. It kind of has this tantalizing moment. What is this? I've never seen one in real life. A riddle that really is part of the pleasures of montage practices. It activates me, it asks me in avant-garde fashion to really become, to offer my own interpretation. At the same time, however, it cannot afford for me to just go wild in the set of readings that I may be able to give, and helps me, in a way, to disambiguate to the meaning of the picture through verbal captioning, right? So that the caption here reads, "Those who read bourgeois newspapers become blind and deaf, away with the stultifying bandages." So the other element that is also kind of very typical for Hartfield here is the use of verbal punning. And so as you see, the image is known as "Ich bin in as the cabbage head montage in German. "Ich bin and the title "Ich bin ein Kohlkopf, kennt ihr meine Blätter?" I am a cabbage head. "Are you familiar with my leaves or my newspapers?" are basically the first two verses in this little, really bad poem that in essence is supposed to be that is spoken in the voice of this kind of duped worker who admits to his own being manipulated by the press by saying, "I am a cabbage head," and here you see my "Are you familiar with my leaves, my newspapers?" And the whole pun here is on the word for newspaper in German, Blatt, which also means leaf. So the whole idea then in punning on the meaning for the for newspaper, Blatt as newspaper and Blatt for leaf, I get the idea not only of a man with his head wrapped in newspapers, but of a cabbage head whose leaves basically occlude vision. So that's basically the kind of complex punning that results from reading the two together. Okay, so and then staying again with the kind of formal strategies that the image itself enacts, you know, I kind of mentioned that this is supposed to be seen, be taken in as a straight photograph, but another element of it is that just simply because of the composition, it really demands to be read as a bust-level portrait, basically, that it really evokes the conventions of photographic portraiture, particularly the conventions that basically ask that the represented person, the depicted person, lock eyes with the viewer. So in the case of portraiture, the question is always, where is the person looking to? Is it looking to the outside of the frame, you know, directly into the viewer? Is it looking to sides and stuff like this? And so in a way, the image both evokes this expectation, there's gonna be a pair of eyes either staring at me or in another direction, and frustrates it, you know. And what interests me here is the fact that in evoking a kind of anthropomorphic illusionism, it really asks us to read this figure as a real person, not just simply as an allegory of the duped worker, but as a person. And it asks us to imagine what it may mean for a person to just simply have newspapers in place of the head. And the reason I say this is that kind of riffing off, if you would, on a comment that the visual theorist John Berger made on Hartfield's photomontages, asking to what extent or when are Hartfield's photomontages art that kind of mediates some kind of critical insight, and when are they just propaganda? Basically, Berger asked to what extent, in essence, what is the line between a certain mode of aesthetic communication or artistic communication that is open enough to really engender critical insight and just simply delivering a message along ideological party lines, you know, and with Hartfield, it is an issue, you know. And Berger says that Hartfield is really at his best, and when the things that are referenced in his very wild photomontages function as things in the first place, and only then as allegorical emblems. So in this case, the idea would be that his images are at their most, you know, really yield critical insight when we are not made to forget. We're asked to read this as a real head made up of newspapers, and this moment of the head made up of newspapers does not simply then retreat and effaces itself behind the meaning, you know, the being duped by the press. And so to me, that's really, again, a kind of a symptom of this understanding of montage, of storytelling as emphasizing the thingness of things, or this kind of moment of material traces that kind of stubbornly hangs in there and is not resolved in just normal strategies of signification. So I just wanted to use this image. And obviously, it's open to interpretation. I'm sure you can take the image as you, you know, just different ways of seeing this. But so I want to stop here, because I know we're going to have to be out of here at 5:30 kind of promptly. But I also want to say about the book, to simply describe, you know, the book is not about advertisement, or propaganda, and I think this is maybe the only image by Hartfield that I describe in the book. So I really make a bit more of a technical argument about storytelling, also latching on to Benjamin, but I just wanted to show you these images in order to, because I thought they made a very concise, hopefully, and vivid point about this kind of storytelling. So thank you so much, and please. Thank you for your question.
Thanks so much, Patrizia. We have about 15 minutes. We really do have to be out of here at 5:30 for questions and comments. And I'll pass around the mic, partly because, again, it's being recorded, so your comments will go along with it.
Well, thank you, Patrizia, very much for your presentation. I'm wondering if you would have come out a little bit different if you had chosen not Hartfield, but Hoechst.
But who?
Because in the case of Hartfield, you clearly have an emphasis on the emblematic side.
Mm-hmm.
The picture, the scripture, that, and the sort of the punning is of great importance here.
Yeah.
So it is on meaning, on message. But of course, ambiguity speaks a great, just as you find it in 17th century emblematic.
Right.
And of course, it's not accidental that Benjamin went back from there to the emblematic art of the 17th century in the Towers people. Sort of, what would happen if you would take different forms of manipulation, like Hoechst, where there is, as far as I recall, no clear meaning
like
at the end?
I'm missing on I can't hear the name. Like who?
Hoechst.
Hoechst. Okay, of course. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that's great. What happens then? Would you come to the same result, or are there different strands of montage? How would you describe this?
That's right.
Exactly. There you
thank you. Yes, exactly. Thank you. That's a great question. Indeed, and these are very different montage practices. What we have here, in fact, is more of a what one could call a collage, and there's no real terminological distinction or firm terminological distinction between collage and montage. But here, what you have, for instance, is an image that kind of in which fragments are kind of pasted. And an image that is not supposed to be reproduced, that one of a kind is supposed to be one of a kind, and that is supposed to be surveyed in very different ways. By the way, this is not a very large image. The fragments are quite small, and so you're supposed to really get very close to it in order to be able to say. But as you said, actually, one way of answering your question is to point to kind of a change in the style of montage practices from the early work of Dadaism to then the 30s, to the late 20s and 30s. And in particular, the fact that with this is now an example of Berlin Dada, there is a privileging, if you would, of this kind of what has been defined as an explosion of fragments, you know, a kind of an image that seems to, does not suggest a specific order composition, and that allows or forces the kind of eye to roam freely, if you would, in search of a narrative to piece together. And then, however, even in an image like this, if you look closely and you stay with it, really what you will recognize are actually two kinds of motion. One that has to do with the demonstrating masses moving to clash against the forces of reaction here, the anti-Dadaists and the anti-Dadaists, and they kind of are supposed to move here in the center of the composition where a headless ballerina is juggling the head of Käthe Kollwitz. So that would be one kind of movement. And then there's actually another kind of movement, which is the movement of the wheels. So the reason why I'm actually emphasizing movement here is, again, to make this idea about perception. The idea that as the eye roams the picture plane, it chances upon instances, if you would, of motion that kind of reflexively emphasize different possibilities of movement, one being unilinear and the other one being circular. In fact, I have a longer reading of this image in a forthcoming article as actually staging two different movements of revolution. The vitalist kind of understanding of revolution as a turning of time onto itself, and a political understanding of revolution as two forces clashing, you know, in a kind of a, and this is Kozelek, obviously, that I'm thinking about, in a kind of more of an emancipatory, unilinear understanding of historical becoming. So all I want to say is that, but that point is carried by the ability of the eye to discern this kind of clashing understandings of movement. So that this would be another example, not necessarily the only one, but yes, and the point that I wanted to make about the kind of historical development of this kind of practice is that this type of chaotic composition, at least at a first glance, then morphs into, certainly by 1923, into kind of a return to figuration and a return to a partially illusionistic space. I don't know that, unfortunately, I don't have images. This may be kind of an example of it. Just simply as a visual style that then can be really enjoined by contemporary advertisement in more effective ways. So just, you know, to keep my answer perhaps short, but.
Yeah, thanks, Patrizia. Mm-hmm. My question is actually pretty much related to that. Can you go back to the Hoech picture?
Sure.
Because I was wondering, to what extent do you see the primacy of montage within avant-garde movements as, and with all its political and philosophical implications, as a typically German phenomenon?
Mm-hmm. No.
And the reason why I'm asking that was primarily when I was looking at this picture, and I noticed, and I heard you talking about it, and I noticed the the similarities with a movement that's called synthetic cubism.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, which you could say, which the Picasso and
right.
Braque in 1912, 1911. And they were actually working with the same kind of strategies. So they were working with the relationship between text and image. They worked with material, how did you say that? The trace of mm-hmm. material traces. Not a narrative. So there are all kinds of similarities, formal similarities, when you look at the coloring, for example. So I was wondering how you understand that, this French development
right.
related to this one.
Absolutely, thank you. That's and in fact, I thank you for the question because it helps me to make clear that I do not claim that these strategies, in fact, are kind of native to a German context. Not at all. And in fact, it's unclear whether the Dadaists gleaned some of this from Picasso's and Braque, as you say, 1911, 1912, you know, the still life with chill caning, you know, the insertions of words joue and stuff like this. What I would, and obviously then there's Italian futurism, you know, Carlo Carrà, you know, the whole, you know, the kind of collages that then also celebrate World War I, you know, and this kind of very bellicose and this vitalist understanding of unleashed masculinity, if you would. So yes, definitely. What I would say very briefly, and not having the Picasso here, is that. And here, Christine Poggi has a great kind of reading of Picasso's and Braque's turn from cubism to collage, which she sees as a necessary kind of step. You know, once cubism is really exhausted, collage is the logical way. But she interprets, and Rosalind Krauss has also written about this. She interprets Picasso's practice of collage is still engaging and you know, if you would, undoing the representational kind of fundamental representational canons of Western painting. So the question, the insertion of real fragments or fragments, you know, that are unsublimated, you know, pieces of experience onto a canvas that is supposed to be two-dimensional is a play in flat, is a basically a play, for instance, with the question of depth or the idea of having a word like joue, you know, being a fragment either for journal or jouer in that picture in the still life with chair caning. Is still a kind of a play with a way of transgressing the prohibition of mixing verbal and visual codes, you know, in the canon of Western painting. And so my very briefly, I would say we're beyond the kind of reflexive play or engagement with the constrictions, with the limitations of visual painting, and we're really at a level of trying to engage perception for perception's sake, forgetting painting is an art that we don't want to worry about even, you know, because in a way it also imposes on us a whole an issue of problems like what is illusionism, what is verisimilitude, that from the perspective of artists at this point are false problems, you know. So that the issue, and just staying within the vocabulary of constructivism, then is no longer representation, Darstellung, which is still a question that Picasso is worrying about, but it's more Gestaltung, forming. I don't worry about things representing other things. I worry about how can I really manipulate, remake the real in this kind of principle via an interaction of technology and perception. And thank you so much for coming. I didn't mean to.
Back corner?
Yes.